Queens College. We are back. Good evening, good day. Whenever you're watching this, it's your main man, Mr. Jeff Dess. And I can't say how excited I am to be here again, rocking with Queens College on behalf of Trill or Not Trill. Here's what we got going for you all today. We've got Queens College Presents Breaking the Bias. We're continuing to celebrate our Women's History Month celebration. And I've got a special guest for you today. In fact, I've got two special guests today. We're going to have an amazing conversation with two amazing friends of mine. And they're going to be talking about the world and the life of being a Black actress here in Hollywood and here in our spaces today. So if you're ready for this conversation, I want you to get excited. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring to the stage two of my folks, my peoples. So if y'all ready for this great conversation, it's going to be a good one. So moving forward, I'd like to bring on L.A. Williams and our special guest as well, Miss Natalie Paul.
Hello, hello.
Hi, thank you so much, y'all. Jeff. Hi, LA.
Hey, Natalie. How you
doing? How are you?
I'm good, sister. How are you?
I'm good. I'm very good.
Good. It's so good to see you. It's so good to see you. I am honored, Natalie, to have this conversation with you. In the spirit of Women's History Month, I think there's no better way to celebrate than to speak to someone such as yourself, a really gifted actress, a very gifted actress and colleague of mine who I've had the pleasure of knowing for years and working with. And I'm just so excited to jump in with you and talk to you about your journey and just make sure that throughout this conversation, we are celebrating the fact that you exist, Natalie, and all the wonderful work that you've given us and all the work that you will give us. So that's sort of the framework of this conversation, right? It's the spirit of celebration, Women's History Month and Black actresses and Natalie Paul and all that you've given to our community and all the things.
Oh my gosh, it's such a pleasure and wow, thank you for that.
You are very, very welcome. Thank you, Natalie. So listen, let's jump right into it. This conversation, as Jeff so beautifully said, we really want to kind of just get in your mind and thought, you know, your thought process in terms of being a Black actress, being an actress, period, and sort of how you navigated the journey and all that. And I think the best way to get into it is to ask, how did you, when did you become an actress? Like, how did you get into this whole world of being an artist and all of that juiciness?
Wow. I don't know how far back you want to go.
As far as you want to take it.
My aunt actually is an incredible actress. And she's an actress, among many other things. She's an activist. She is an all-around Renaissance woman in Haiti and in France. So my mother's Haitian, of course, her sister. So every summer when I was a kid, we would go to Haiti. And I always feel that those summers really were where my artistic self was born, because it was a time where I could be outside. I grew up in Brooklyn, and just being in New York, the primary way I was protected and sheltered was just by being inside and reading books and school and sort of being a little bit afraid of out there. But when I would go to Haiti in the summers, it was a way for my mom to make sure that I stayed connected with my heritage. But it was also a time when I would, you know, gosh, we would be playing outside all day, getting dirty, getting, you know, playing with my cousins and putting on plays. doing the crazy things. We would, you know, of course, you know, we would be in the wild and be like killing little, you know, furry little animals and then putting on whole funerals for them. You know what I mean? Naming them, say, you know, like dreaming up worlds outside. And just that was really a true childhood for me was when I would go to home, real home. And so my aunt was an actress, and so I would watch her in plays out in Haiti, in Port-au-Prince. And she was absolutely stunning. And of course, also her husband, the late Elvis Denis, who was also a giant in Haiti. He's done so many things for the country. He was also an actor, and he and they both were in a theater group that they founded together. And so when I was a child, I would see them perform, and it just planted that seed. You know, I would come back to New York and be a really good student and just be a good girl, but I always knew that there was more than just these boxes, these, you know, like New York is just a bunch of boxes, right? It feels like this grid system. And so out there, everything felt more wild, a little bit more creative, a little bit more connected to who I really was. And so just watching them, and then of course it would be, you know, first it was as a child, then it was as a teenager. And that really informed me. That informed like the other side of me is the way I kind of think of it. It's just the side of me that I feel like I switch into when I perform that is completely limitless. And my father was a huge, huge fan of movies. We watched some great films when I was just a kid, maybe probably too young. And that also fostered my love of performance and storytelling. And it's so funny because even when I fast forward to like when I was in grad school, like one of my best teachers was my mom, because she was such a strong arbiter of authenticity in my life. So I kind of feel like it started with family, seeing it, of course, definitely. And this is the thing, it's like seeing my aunt and my uncle act. They would take on huge epic plays, right? Huge epic French plays. They did the Derek Walcott trilogy about Haiti in French. They did these huge plays about, you know, the roi Christophe, which was this, you know, the first king of Haiti, and it was like so epic and big, and I hadn't seen that in in someone who looked like me yet, and definitely not incorporating some of our native performance culture, which I think I'm still always trying to learn it, you know what I mean? Like when we talk about what a Black artist is, it's not just representation, but it's the moral quality of that representation. Do you know what I mean? And seeing that so early on in my life, that there was an aesthetic that I could plug into, that I had a lineage of a theatrical lineage. That was so important because that's something that I bring to roles. So that it's not necessarily that I'm always that we're in these some of these spaces asking to learn how do I act. We have heritage, and we have history, we have lineage, and we have ways and techniques that that sometimes we don't even know about, but I got a chance to see it, you know, really early on. And so I incorporate it all, and I'm proud of all the languages I speak, you know, and all the spaces that I inhabit. So that's a very long answer to how did I become an actress, but that was part of it, because then when I started to learn, when I started to take classes here in New York, I took so many classes growing up, and taking classes with all kinds of people, that was something I could bring to the table. And so I'm very grateful for that, and very grateful for just being exposed to that. I'm so grateful that my mom got, you know, put us on that plane every summer and said, you're going to know who you are. You're not going to be an orphan out here. So, so that was part of it. It's like, it was, acting has always been part and parcel with history, culture, identity for me. It's not been this just like purely creative thing, or I don't know, is creativity even pure of all these other things, right? Like they're, it's, I think it's hard to divorce them. And so I'm you know, I'm always kind of using art to investigate those things about myself that I don't know about yet, that I'm still trying to learn, you know. So that's kind of how it started and how it's always evolving.
I love, Natalie, that's so beautiful. Thank you for that gorgeous depiction of your time as a child growing up and going back and forth in the summers. And thank you for really laying out the space in which you were able to sort of imagine and play.
Yes. Right?
And create and like all of those things so essential to the work of an actor and to being an artist. And I love to hear you talk about how you are aware of that now and you try to bring that into everything you do now. I mean, that is a gorgeous, gorgeous, beautiful journey. Thank you for sharing that.
Yeah, God. Absolutely.
So when Natalie, I love that you already hit on, you know, taking classes and doing things as a young adult and as a teenager. When would you say was the moment where you were like, okay, I want to do this professionally. I want to like really invest and, you know, sort of give my life to it in that way.
That's a good question. I think I made that decision a few times.
Yes, exactly.
I think that's how they get you. You know, you come into it like, I think I'll just try it out and da da da. But I think in college I studied theater, and I wasn't sure exactly where in theater I really fit. Sometimes I always loved acting, but I didn't know how you made that work until I got a little bit further into my studies and I started meeting people who were doing this as a living that would like do theater and go to do regional theater and do readings and make it a whole lifestyle that I really, because I thought, you know, up until then you think a job, you know.
Right. And absolutely. Yeah.
I think that's what I've learned is, and I'm still trying to challenge myself to constantly think of it as a lifestyle.
Yes.
And not just I played this character in that, but what else happened, you know?
Right. Yeah.
Who else did I, who did I meet? What did I learn about myself? Where were the places I went to get coffee on my breaks? Like all that is part of being a professional actor.
Yeah, yes. Yes.
And so for me, it was college. I started to meet people. I went to Yale. And so I met a bunch of like really incredible artists at the drama school. And they put me on game. And so then I just realized, okay, if I put my mind to this, I can do it.
Yeah.
So I was doing directing, I was writing, I was acting. And then, so that was one thing. And then when I graduated, I was super scared. I was like, not yet.
Yeah.
So I tried some other things and it never took. And then, so then I went back for grad school knowing that I needed real training because Yale undergrad theater is great, but it's not conservatory training.
That's right. Yeah.
Conservatory training is all day, every day, first of all. And it's like, it's those 10,000 hours of just constantly.
Yes.
Doing the same thing over and over and over again until it becomes part of you. It was somewhere between, it was like in college and then again after college. And then, you know, about 15, 25 times since then.
Exactly.
It's grad school where you're like, you have to recommit every time. You can get into a groove and be good and not have to think about your commitment. And then you're confronted with things and then you have to recommit.
Absolutely.
You know, it's just like any relationship.
Yes. Yes.
Where you ride the waves and it does require conscious choice to stay in it at times.
Yes.
And so, yeah, but I think being in school and I'll never forget even watching like certain movies, like Love and Basketball, and thinking, okay, that's somebody that's doing something interesting that I like.
Yes.
You know, because before that it was like you better be able to sing, dance, do a backflip. You can't just act.
You can't just act, right? Yes, that's true. Yeah.
As a black young girl, that's what my impression of being a performer was, well, you better have it all.
Right,
I'll tell you right now, I don't. I'm an actor, period.
Yeah.
You know, I I do see myself doing other things, mm-hmm. but you know, I'm not that particular kind of, you know, we all know those amazing people. And it was like, for a while I was afraid that I couldn't do this just the same way some of my counterparts can. Mm-hmm. But that was a movie that definitely gave me a lot of inspiration. Been like, oh, she's literally just acting.
She's just acting.
And she's doing an amazing job, and I'm here for it. And it's and it's edifying to me as a young Black girl in high school who wants to see love portrayed, or you know, all these things. Yes. And it's speaking to me on a deeper level, you know? Yeah. So that really super inspired me. And that was like, okay, that's something I could do. I could do something like that.
Ooh, Natalie, that's so gorgeous. Oh my God. I love all of that. And yes, Love and Basketball was a big project for me that kind of inspired me.
Right?
Yes, absolutely. So I just love that you're like shouting that out. That is so funny.
Yeah, that's so funny. I mean, that was big for me in high school, for sure.
Gosh, I know, right? And I love what you said about it was just pure acting, right?
It was a journey. It was the development of a character. It was just life.
Yes.
Truthful life. Like, and I don't think, you know, stories like that are still few and far between, where it's just a story about a person.
I love that.
Developing, taking herself through an arc, and for a Black female to get that full character arc.
Yeah. Woo, Natalie, I have to say thank you again. And I want to just carve out a moment in this conversation too, in the spirit of Women's History Month and Black actresses. You're really inspiring me to celebrate Sanaa Lathan's performance in Love and Basketball, and what it did for so many of us, and what it did for you. And thank you, Natalie, for bringing that into this space. Because
absolutely, she was definitely a turning point for me, and I feel that even, you know, it just so many and so many others, right? Like, there are so many amazing. Performers, actors, artists that have carved out new lanes of truth, right? In acting, on film, in television.
Yes.
And she was definitely one of those for me. I'm trying to think of other ones, but right now that was definitely so seminal, because I remember having the DVD and being in school and just so many other, and I think it's getting, I mean, like Issa Rae, right? Like, in a way you can draw a straight line to Issa Rae.
Totally,
And she's a huge inspiration to me. Yeah. I hope to work with her one day. Yeah. Like, she's so, there are certain characters and performers and stories that carve out what it's like on the inside.
Yes, absolutely.
Not what it's like for being looked at but not seen, but stories that reveal, right? That like bring forward who we really are. And yet still we're still just talking about movies and TV. But those are the things that heal us at the end of the day. We go out, we live our lives, and we click on TV and film to relax, to escape, to, you know, to imagine, and to turn off the stresses of what we're going through.
Yes.
And Black women are no different from anyone else in needing that escape.
Yes.
And so some of these stories, even though they're about love or whatever, being awkward, they do something really profound, you know, especially right now when we're talking about mental health and things of that nature. I mean, for me, some of these movies were my mental health before I had access to a therapist or practice.
You know? Yes.
I didn't know anything about a practice when I was in a predominantly white high school trying to figure myself out. I didn't know anything about that.
Right.
You know, and that was my practice. And so acting has always been that for me.
In a way,
it's been this outlet, you know, it's been my journaling. And now I think I'm a bit wiser in that I can journal before I act. So it's more of a service.
Yes.
Both to myself and to others, but art has always been that for society, you know?
Yeah.
Just being a healer, a kind of a fun therapist. So I hope that's what I do when I work, when I'm, you know.
So good. That's so good and juicy. You've touched on so many important points. One of the ones I want to sort of tease out is, introduce into the conversation, is talk to us a little bit about how you navigate the industry as a Black actress. Now that you're like in it, I mean, you have done some incredible work. I've had the great fortune of working with you in the theater. We did Romeo and Juliet together at the Classical Theater of Harlem. Before that, you did some shows at Portland Center Stage. Oh, was it Portland Main Stage or what's
the name? Portland Center Stage.
Portland Center Stage. You were in a play there. And, you know, I know you did a show at Humana Festival in Louisville, Kentucky. So, but what's it been like for you navigating this business yourself as a Black actress?
Well, I will say I'm very thankful to mentors and community. Because that is a huge resource in navigating. Mm-hmm. But I think what's important is having a true north and knowing what you want, You know, there's so much talk about how to make your dreams come true and all that, and a lot of it just is the simplest thing, which is knowing what your dreams are. Because then when anything that comes up and doesn't match up against it, you know what choice you're making.
Absolutely.
And sometimes you don't have the privilege, right?
Right.
You don't have the privilege. And I think that is, that's a real thing. But I hope I'm batting at least 95.
Yes.
In sticking to what I set out to do. So I think your navigation, you're knowing where you're going.
Going, yes.
Is part of that navigation.
Yes.
And I feel that knowing that it's a still ongoing fight.
Yes. Yeah.
I mean, as a woman, we've just, you know, gone through Me Too and all that. And as a Black woman, these fights are not over. And so I think if anyone's in the audience who wants to do this, you know, they have to be aware that you're not separate from those fights. And that, you know, what looks like a loss is not sometimes because it's connected to something bigger.
Gosh. Right?
And so, and the gains as well, right? Mm-hmm. And the wins as well are also connected to something bigger. So I think navigation is about really, really being clear on what you want. You know, going for it as much as you can, you know. I read something today that was like, shoot all the shots. Shoot all the shots, the career
shots. Shoot all the shots.
The health shot, the relationship shot. Shoot all your shots.
All the shots.
But the one thing I didn't read was also take all your shots.
Take all your shots. Ah, that's dope.
Right?
Yes.
Like,
yes.
There's an endurance game. It's a long game.
It's a long game.
I think that is probably the most relevant thing about being an actress is that you have to have your eye on, you know, the long game.
The long game.
Right? Yeah. It's a long-term commitment.
Yes.
So, I mean, and taking care of yourself, you know, and knowing not to, and when I say take all the shots, don't take them personally. That's exactly what I don't mean. It's like, don't take them personally. Like, that is what allows you to weather the storm and take the rejection. Because this is a path filled with rejection.
Yes. But
you cannot interpret it as a rejection of you.
Right. Yes.
You know, and I think. That's the hardest thing to learn, and that is definitely like a learning curve with that. When you first start, you're just like, you're on the floor every day.
Exactly.
Because you're like, yay, it's me, look at me. And you know, sometimes the industry totally responds to you right away, and that's great, but that wasn't the case for me.
It was
definitely more gradual. Yeah. And I'm still, you know, still on the journey.
That's right.
And so it's about, like, it doesn't get easier, but you do get stronger.
That's right.
You know?
Yeah.
Navigation, man, it is like driving a car. Like, you want to make sure you have gas in your gas in the tank, and you know,
clear
the tires,
oil checked, all the things.
All of it,
Natalie. I love, because you're gonna go through a lot of different elements driving that car.
You're gonna go through a lot of seasons.
Yes.
And you come to realize that you can't change with the season. Like, you can adjust to it, but you can't allow the season.
That's right.
To change your commitment level and your sense of self and self-worth.
Yes.
My goodness. Yes. You know,
yes.
Imagine you felt like it was raining inside every time it physically rained. You can't do that. You just can't do that. And this industry is the same way. One day it will, oh my gosh, 3 callbacks? It's over for y'all. And then the next day you realize you didn't get none of them callbacks.
Exactly. Yes.
You know, it's a constant up and down, but you have to find a very steady center.
Center.
You know? Yeah. Or at least a way to get back to it.
Mm-hmm. Natalie, listen, I love it. You be preaching and teaching, and there's so much wisdom in what you're saying. Thank you so much, Natalie. I want to ask you, so I mentioned some of your theater work. Mm-hmm. You've had the great fortune of transitioning into TV and film and other mediums as an actor. Mm-hmm. And working in Hollywood. So can you just talk a little bit about, you know, the transition from, like, you know, that deep sort of conservatory training and working in the theater live into, like, working on shows like, you know, The Sinner and like Show Me a Hero and like The Deuce. I mean, you know, and your big movie debut, which was Crown Heights. Like, what was the transition like, or is it a transition, or what's the difference there?
Well, there's definitely a difference in technique and what's required. I would say, I mean, everybody says this, but it's kind of true. You know, when you're on theater, the proscenium is what? How many feet wide?
Right.
When you're on film, the proscenium is this wide.
Right. Right.
So that adjusts the way you would speak, right? Like, I mean, I think in general, I'm a Leo. I don't know what that really means, but I'm a little bit gregarious. So sometimes I have to work on getting really precise for film and TV. And that's the thing, that's the difference, right? Like, when you're on stage, it requires so much giving, like giving of yourself, giving of your voice, throwing your whole mind, body, and soul into this performance.
Yeah.
It's a concert in a way, you know? And I'm definitely, like, not an acting teacher, but that's what it was like for me. That was my sort of, like, motto or credo is, like, okay, like, it's time to give.
Yes.
Serve.
Yes.
Like, yes. Give yes. everything you yes. got every time.
Yeah.
And of course you want to be you want to serve the story as well in film and TV, but it's much more intimate.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's actually more, I want to let you in.
Yeah.
In TV and film. Yeah. So I think making that adjustment was, was one. Because I remember my first time on a TV set, I was on Boardwalk Empire, and everything, I felt like I couldn't hear a thing. Everyone was whispering. I was like, what? I'm sorry, what? What are you saying? Everybody was whispering. The director was whispering.
Everybody,
the actors I couldn't understand a thing. And I was like, hi, you know, like super green. And so I just, and then, you know, it was the director being like, or even actually my audition for Boardwalk Empire, I just remember just now, she was like, you could take it down a notch. Just, I was like, oh, really? Oh, okay. Okay. So it was again, the same thing on set, like trying to get direction, you know, and just always bringing it down and really, yeah. really getting relaxed. And
yeah. like,
you really think this is going to happen? You know, yeah. like that yeah. is the act, that is yeah. The TV transition right yeah. there. Mm-hmm. And also, but also it was the long days, right? Rehearsal. Mm-hmm. Transitioning to, you know, TV rehearsal is not like theater rehearsal. It's might as well be two different words, really.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, exactly. I mean,
rehearsal in theater is, you know, you rehearse something for 6 weeks and it's every day for, you know, 6 hours a day, and then you show it to the world. TV, it's rehearsal is, okay, this is where you're going to stand. Then you're going to sit down, stand up, turn around. Okay, cool. Center the hair and makeup. Come back. Exactly. And you do a couple thing. Takes
yeah.
or whatever. And yeah. So that was a transition. So so with TV, you have to be ready. You know, and your audition is really an audition of, I mean, it's a little similar in theater, but theater, you know, you come in, it's a little bit more artistic, I mm-hmm. feel, in a sense. I mean, it's obvious, I guess. When I say artistic, not that television isn't art, but that it's more, what's the word? It's more open.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And like auditioning for television is like, this is exactly how I'm going to do it.
Yeah. 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 Exactly.
When I get on set.
Yeah. Yeah, 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 yeah.
You know,
yeah.
so that's the implicit contract you're making. And then, because when you get on set, they're just going to expect you to do what you did in the audition. Just do it again.
Right, you right. Know?
Exactly. There's not like, so what do you think she's, what do you think? There's none of that. There's no thinking, yeah. really. And yeah. that's one of the fun parts about being on set. It's just such an electric place.
Yeah.
You know, there's not a lot of like rumination. It's constant go. Dude, and yeah, it's yeah. all day, and it just happens that day. And there's just something really special about how every day on a show, for example, is different from the day before. You're never, you know, coming back to a scene. It's yeah. just done. And and being comfortable with watching yourself, that's a big transition. It's like with theater, yeah. there's so much lack of self-consciousness, mm-hmm. really, because you're never going to see yourself in that play. You might right. see a picture,
right?
But you're never going to see yourself doing it. And so there's right. an incredible amount of freedom in that.
Yes.
I feel like when you see yourself on television or in a film, you're like, I'll do that, you know, like I'm sure I'm gonna watch this back over and be like, oh my god. You know, you just have yeah. to be super okay. Or and that, which is why I don't really watch myself very much, because it can get you in your head.
Totally.
So those are like some of the things. And I think in general, you know, I don't know that I think I'm still learning how to navigate this like industry, you know. I'm still learning how to do this thing. I'm still learning how to like both be really sensitive and mm-hmm. and be able to access that artistic side of myself at a moment's notice, and also be strong enough to post a picture of myself on Instagram, you know, like yeah. that to me requires strength, because it's absolutely. A sense of like marketing and
yes.
promotion and just showing up and slaying and all this stuff yeah. and I know in myself I can do both, but there's a sense of like just going back and forth sometimes. Can you have to really take care of yourself?
Yeah.
Because it's like flipping a sweater inside out constantly.
Yeah. Yeah.
This work is, you know, like going in and coming out.
Yes. Shining. Yeah.
I don't know.
I love that, Natalie. Yeah. So juicy. That's also juicy. I'm thinking a lot about our audience here at Queens College. And I wonder if there was one sort of tip that you would give young actors in terms of the business of acting or how to go about the business of acting? Thank you for talking about the sort of art and craft of it, but I wonder if.
That's a good question. I think you have to really, really come in with a sense that there's only one of you. Mm-hmm. And if they want you, mm-hmm. then there's a certain sense of like authority you have to walk in before mm-hmm. someone throws you a parade. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so that sense of authority in your craft and what you do, because when you walk into those rooms, mm-hmm. you walk into those audition rooms, it's just you. Right. It's not your team. It's not right. your acting teacher. Right. It's not nobody. It's you.
It's you.
And you are the leader. Mm-hmm. You are the catalyst. You mm-hmm. are the answer, not mm-hmm. them. You know, mm-hmm. so I think when navigating this business, you kind of have to constantly, you know, refresh mm-hmm. that yeah. sense of authority inside yeah. of you. Because yes. as an actor, if you come into it begging, mm-hmm. if you come into it with your hand out, if you come into it not wanting to be validated by outside sources, it's quicksand.
It's quicksand.
It's emotional quicksand.
You
know, like you just fall right through the floor.
Yeah.
And so I would just suggest, like, while you're young, you know, when you're young, that is the time to be bold. That is the time to believe in yourself the most, because yeah. the canvas is clear.
Yeah.
And there's nothing like that first impetus to yeah. go after something. And so I would say enjoy it, but also come in with, you know, I know it's hard to say, it's easier said than done.
Yeah.
But if there is a time to be bold and there's a time to know who you are and to walk in authority, it's exactly at this point when you're young mm-hmm. and you're new. I mean, be humble, be yes. polite,
yes.
you know, do what you have to do, totally. But that boldness has to be there at this. My dad always told me this, start where you want to end up.
Yes.
You have to come from that place that yeah. it is done, that it yeah. will happen.
Yeah.
Because like I said, the onslaught of doubt and the onslaught of people trying to take advantage of you and people trying to take you off your path is real.
It's real.
It's an uphill thing.
Yes.
So you got to come in with a lot of energy. You got to
right.
start with that energy.
That's right.
It's really hard to get that energy while you're in mid stride.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because
yeah.
it's already happening. You're already yeah. dealing with things coming at you.
Yeah.
And so I don't know if that's too abstract, but I would say there's that. And I would say, you know, be very, very mindful of how you spend your money. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of people out there that are want to take advantage of a dreamer, mm-hmm. which is why that's why I'm saying is like have that authority over that dream.
Yeah. Yeah.
Protect that dream, nurture yeah. that dream. You know, it's a baby.
Yes.
Think of it as like a little baby that you're trying to raise in a very, very hostile world. And this industry isn't, I hate to say it, but it's not easy. It's just not easy. It's hard. It's extremely subjective.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of uncertainty, yeah. which is why, again, you have to start with a sense of knowing who you are. And I'm sure that if this is something that is calling you, then it's real. That's the thing. Like, I think I would have said that to myself starting out, is like, you know, your dream is real.
Yes.
Your dream is real. Like, you know, and I think sometimes we want it to happen to us or kind of like see it before, you know, just to get a little confirmation, but just the fact that you have it is confirmation.
It's real.
You know, so
definitely.
So, put some weight on that, you know, use that sense of, use that dream to, you know, go out there and make it happen. You know, it's not, it feels, I know it feels like uncertain, but that is just about as certain as it gets.
That's about as certain as it gets.
That's the thing.
That's
as certain as it gets.
That's as certain as it gets.
If you're waiting for certainty to show up, You already have it.
You already have it.
You already have it. And it's in the form of that feeling inside of you. And so if you can feel it inside of you, if you can and believe in it, it will come to pass, I believe. Because I know there are so many times where, like, honestly, this path has surprised me. Mm-hmm. And it reminded me that, oh, it's because my dream is real.
It was always real.
It was always real. It wasn't like, you know, some kind of delusion.
Yes.
And it's real to the extent that you believe in it.
Yeah, it's real.
So, and that's all in all of our power, you know. And I'm not saying this, and I'm trying to preach to myself right now.
That's right. Because
it needs constant watering, you know.
Constant watering.
Constantly reminded. Yes. Yeah. Put in the front of your mind.
I love that, Natalie. What I love the most about what you just shared and all that you've shared is, I was going to add, my next question for you was going to be, how do we refresh? How do we recommit? How do we remind? And I think that you said it, you know, in all of the, you've said it quite a bit throughout this, but I want to just carve out a second, if there's like one practical thing that you do to reset or to refresh or recommit.
Well, I definitely, you know, there are certain practices, like I do exercise to help me, like, kind of get out of my head, because usually sometimes after, you know, running for 20 minutes, you just are so tired that your brain is just different.
Exactly.
But, you know, there's that. Of course, like, you know, speaking, you know, sometimes reaching out to my mentors and being like, I don't know what I'm doing.
And, exactly. Yes.
Reaching out to the people that, And someone who knows you really well, someone you know won't, you know, shoot down your dream.
Yes, right.
Reading a good acting book, like just reconnecting with the craft of it, you know. Yes. Reading a really good monologue sometimes just like reminds me, like, oh, I'm kind of good at this.
Yeah. You know? Yes.
And like sometimes even just writing is really great, because it just gets all that stuff out. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And sometimes you're like, is it really like physically getting outside of your brain? Yes, it is.
Yes, it is. It absolutely,
you
it
really absolutely sometimes is. Need, if it's stopped up, you know, it can create so much tension. And so just anything that relieves tension, you know, like a good cry, a good talk with a friend, like, deep, you know, unplugging and watching an old movie. Oh, there's nothing like when you need to reconnect with that child part of you, it's like, watch Back to the Future. Mm-hmm. You're gonna be like, oh, it's so simple what I want to do. It's so simple.
Oh, good. Yeah.
You know, or like, or watch something even much older, you know, so that you are taken to another place of like deep drama, you know, like All About Eve or something. Yes. Like, oof, that was, you know, just anything that just always try to remember who those childhood heroes were. And I think that will bring you back to, you know, the truth of who you are and what you want to do. You know, your influences also are part of your special sauce. Mm-hmm. You know, and sometimes you need to reconnect with those because they help you be the actor that you are. And and your combination of influences, right? Like I mentioned some random things, but whatever it is for you, it's like, I think some of the things that I think we are all original. I think that's true, but we're also so much of what's been put inside of us, and that the way those things interact, that will never be done again. So I think like reconnecting with your influences and how they interact, you know, like why do I both like, you know, Back to the Future and Love and Basketball? Like, why? That's a Natalie thing.
Yeah.
You know, that why. Do I love about, you know, Soldier Story?
Yeah.
You know, or... gosh, so many things. Do the Right Thing, like all these different films that inform who I am, like what is it about them? And then when you start to articulate that, that's when you start to own that special sauce you have inside of you. It's not just happening to you. Right. It's not just like some, it's real and it's real. True and it deserves to be seen.
Mm. You know? Ooh. That's so juicy, Natalie. That's so good and so full. Thank you. I have like two or three little things swirling in my mind. I'm going to pick one. In the spirit of celebration and being a Black actress, is there a moment in your career thus far that you can say was a highlight or is a highlight or that you just want to celebrate and sort of just acknowledge as a win or not win, but like just in the spirit of like celebrating yourself and your journey and how far you've come thus far?
Mm. I don't know that I'm there yet.
Okay.
Like, I don't know. I feel very much a work in progress, but there are so many times, actually, so many highlights in a sense.
Yep.
It's like none and so many at the same time.
Yep.
It was an honor. It's always an honor to play someone who really actually lived. It was a total honor to play Antoinette.
Mm-hmm.
It was an honor to play Doreen Henderson.
Mm-hmm.
Because those were just incredible women that you know, endured such adversity. Yes. And just being able to step inside of those shoes. Antoinette Warner, my gosh, just meeting her was an honor, much less to play her. So those were definitely two really big moments for me. Mm-hmm. And you know, even I've only been to one award ceremony, but going to the NAACP Image Award was really amazing. Yeah. Even like You, my little role on You, I feel like that was just really fun. And the way I, you know, just my personality in general, I tend to live on the darker side in a sense, like, or the sad side of things. Like, I'm just a little melancholy. And so being a part of something that was like so commercial and kind of fun and juicy and like, I mean, yeah, there was like some horror elements to it, but you know, I don't know, just being part of something that like mainstream was very fun and like, oh, okay, I guess I could do this too. Like, it's not all, it doesn't all have to be Shakespeare.
Right, that's right.
Yeah, and the character was really dope. So I don't know, but I would say like, you know, Antoinette Warner and Doreen Henderson were like, are still really much, really alive in me when I think about what little things I've done that make me proud and that I hope I'm remembered for. I think those two are, there's just incredible women that I still look up to and I hope I made them proud.
Mm. Natalie, well, I am just so honored again to have this conversation with you. I think you're one of the most talented people I know, and as evidenced in this conversation, extremely bright and wise and generous, and I just thank you and I celebrate your journey, and I'm so happy to know you. And
I love you, LA, and I hope we get to work together again soon.
Me too.
This has been such a great conversation. I've never been asked so many deep questions.
I know.
I feel so like this is like my Charlie Rose moment. I mean, whatever.
Exactly.
But
I mean,
thank you so much for facilitating this incredible conversation, and I hope out there that people are encouraged.
Yes.
To, you know, just to watch a movie with a Black woman in it.
Yes.
You know, to and if you know someone who, you know, wants to be an actor or wants to tell stories, you know, encourage them.
Yeah.
If it's not you, be the one in their life to encourage them and give them faith and a sense of possibility, because I do believe that dreams do come true when you believe in them.
That's
and I feel like I am making my, you know, 18-year-old self very proud right now. Like, I don't think my 18-year-old self would have guessed I had been on HBO or anything. So or anything of that nature, or been in a movie and all that. Like, I did not know it was going to happen for me.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if you don't know right now, it doesn't mean that it's not going to happen. So I just hope, like, if you're a young actor, to go for it. Mm. And if you're a friend of a young actor, to just be that voice of support.
Yeah. And I'll take something I learned from you today, Natalie. And that is, and if you are the young person who wants to be an actor, be that voice for yourself. Be that voice for yourself. Encourage yourself. You know what I mean? Like, I feel like the things I've taken from this conversation is that you have to be that voice for
yourself.
Affirm yourself, right? And affirm others, right? And the more actually what I've learned is the more we affirm ourselves, the more we are able to affirm others. Mm-hmm. Thank you for
and
that.
You are that for me, for sure. And I hope I'm that for you, LA.
Absolutely.
Because you're an incredible artist as well.
Thank you.
I can't wait to be doing this for you one day.
I know. I can't wait. I know. Because you got questions. And I mean, clearly you got some good answers too. It's hard for me to believe you haven't been asked some good juicy deep questions like this.
Not this hour long.
I love it. This has been wonderful. Is there anything else, Natalie, on your heart and mind that you want to share or lay out or put into the universe?
No, just, you know, like, if you, you know, it's like, if you could believe it, you can achieve it. That's always my message. But no, I'm just very thankful. And I want to thank Queens College for having me, because it's always a privilege to speak. And I hope I was able to help someone today. And, you know, thank you.
Thank you, everyone. You certainly have been a gift. You are a gift. We love you, Natalie. We celebrate you. We celebrate all the Black actresses.
Yes.
Women's History Month. We celebrate all the young folks watching this and the not so young folks, the mature, whoever's watching this. We celebrate you. We love you. We believe in you. Believe in yourself. And this is all good. This is all very good.
Thank you, LA. And thank you, Queens College.
Thank you, Natalie.
And thank you, Trill or Not Trill.
Yes. Yes. Thank you, Jeff. Trill or Not Trill. Thank you, Queens College. This has been a beautiful conversation. I'm so honored to have been a part of it. And I thank you all so much.
Yes.
All righty.
Bye.
See you later.